So I ran into Matt Adams out in the foyer just before we began, and he was looking at the bulletin. He saw that there was part one and part two from Pete and I, and he said, so the mothers just needed one sermon, but apparently the fathers need two. That is not the case. And I want to let you know, my part one will be short. I don't know about Pete's, so you know, after I'm done, you're on your own. But Pete will be out here shortly. So 2 years ago, I was hired as your senior minister. Well, almost 2 years ago. It'll be 2 years ago this coming July. But so 2 years from about now, I think around May, I sat right where you sat, and I was on a covert mission. I was here to spy on all of you. Now, the elders knew that I was here. I'd already started the interview process, but I was here to interview, to check all of you out, and to see what all this buzz was about with this Pete dude. So I came, checked him out, but mostly it was not about Pete, it was about all of you. And I was here to just kind of see how things went here. You just didn't know it. I brought my wife and my kids, and I got to tell you, we were impressed. We were blessed that day. The service was good and orderly. You were friendly, not just to me. I watched how you interacted with one another. The atmosphere was cheerful. There were plenty of smiles. And like I said, both my wife and I, we were impressed. This felt like home, our first time here. But, no, there wasn't a but. We were excited. We were looking forward to the possibility of being a part of Jerome's family. And over the past couple years that we have, let me tell you, we have been blessed. It has been wonderful, but it has gone by quickly. And we are so pleased that the church has continued to grow. Involvement is up. Members are joining the church on a consistent basis, and offerings are up. And it's not all about the numbers. But from a Sunday morning perspective, things are good. And I like good. I like smooth sailing. I like joy and peace in my family and in my church family, because it makes my job as senior minister a lot easier when things are good. But something has been eating at me for several months, and I've tried to set it aside, but it's something I believe God has just put on my heart, and I've tried to say, Lord, not right now, because things are good. But as your senior minister, I would not be doing my job if I ignored what God was laying on my heart. It's my job not to ignore it. It's my job to evaluate how we're doing. How we're doing right now. How are things? And possibly where are we headed next? Or where is God leading us next? So I've got Pete's clicker. I don't have my clicker today. This was supposed to make it smoother. Hopefully it does. Ah, very good. So look at this, Proverbs 4:26. It says, know where you are headed and you will stay on solid ground. And so I don't want you to misunderstand what I'm saying this morning. I feel that we are at a good place. I feel that we are on solid ground. But wisdom says to know where you are headed so that you can stay on solid ground. So two or three months ago, the elders and I we took a Saturday to assess and evaluate where we're at. Not just where we're at, but where God might be leading us next. And it was during this Saturday that we took that I was able to discuss what had been gnawing at me, what I believe God had been laying on my heart. And it was this. I feel that as a church, we could do a better job with our commitment to the Great Commission. If you don't remember what that is, look here in Matthew 28. It says, Jesus came and said to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And every church, you know, tries to put their own little spin and how to succinctly communicate that this is the mission that we have been tasked with by Jesus. And so we have shortened it down into three words. If you don't already know, here they are. Win, build, send. And so we define our mission as this: win, build, send. We want to win by leading people to Christ. We want to build by continuing to disciple new Christians and each other as we grow in maturity with Christ. We want to give emphasis to that. And then we want to send people out into our community and into the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. So that Saturday, we took some time to evaluate how well we are doing with winning, with building, and with sending. And so we began with winning. And we evaluated that, and we quickly were able to recognize, with a little bit of discussion, that we could do a better job with winning. Because we have had a lot of growth, but a lot of our growth has come from other Christians transferring their membership into the church. And so we want to do a better job at reaching out to those who have no church background, the lost and the unsaved. So that was the first thing that we were able to recognize. And then we took a look at build. And we didn't spend a lot of time at build because, honestly, for the majority of my time here this past couple years, that's been my primary focus, is looking at how to continue to build the health of the congregation. And we're not perfect, but we felt that is headed in a good direction. And then finally, we looked at sin. And we decided and recognized that, yes, we're doing a good job with sending. Like, for example, we send a lot of money into the mission field. I think we sent almost $200,000 off to support different missionaries last year, and that is good. And we recognize that informally, we send out families into our community, or they grow up here and they go and live in other communities, and they're able to put down roots and be fruitful where they are. But we recognize that we want to be more intentional with our send. And so overall, we come to this conclusion that we want our church to be more engaging with the mission of the church. So on behalf of the church leadership, I want to challenge our church body this morning to engage the mission that we've all been called to, not just the church as a whole, but individually. We are called to the mission. And so our challenge to you is this, is we want to engage the mission by doing this, by reaching, teaching, and preaching. So let me explain what I mean by reaching, teaching, and preaching. We want to engage the win responsibility that we have by reaching out to the lost, intentionally reaching out to those who are far from God in our community. We want to engage the build by teaching, by continuing to teach, by continuing to emphasize to our parents and our grandparents and our mentors that we all need to be committed to continuing our relationship with God's word and spreading the good news of Jesus Christ to our people. And then we want to engage the send by not just sending money, but by also sending people. I mean, we've got a couple of mission trips coming up. In fact, there's a meeting next week for our mission trip this fall out to Sholo, Arizona. And then next spring, my wife and I are leading a mission trip to Zimbabwe, Africa. And these are just two examples of how we want to see more engagement with our sending. But pertinent to our new summer series that we're starting today, we want to send our congregation into the community to preach the gospel. And I don't mean stand up on the street corner and preach the gospel. I mean preach the gospel by sharing your story, your testimony with others, and how Jesus has changed your life, how Jesus is your life. We want to be encouraging our people to be intentional about preaching the gospel in their homes, at school, at work, in the community. We want you to be having red letter conversations when those opportunities arise. And for those of you who are not real good with words, I can't remember where this quote is from, but I think many of you have heard it. It goes like this: I would rather see a sermon than hear one any day. Have you heard that before? So in that sense, we can encourage one another to be red letter examples in our homes, in our community, in our workplace, be mentors. People who don't just say the way to Jesus, but show the way to Jesus, that walk the way to Jesus. Now, this call that I'm giving the church this morning to engage the mission will challenge your will. Hear me on that. This call for us all to engage the mission will challenge our will. It's challenging mine because it is not my will to lead a mission trip to Africa next spring. I do not like to travel. In fact, if it's over 30 minutes, it better be for some good food or a good golf course or something good. But I just don't like to travel. And so traveling halfway across the world, I'm not really into it. My wife loves it, but I'm not a big fan of traveling. But when it comes to following Christ, that's what's required of us. Not traveling halfway across the world, but submitting and surrendering to Jesus' will. And so that's the challenge. That's the challenge for our church, to submit to the will of our Savior. There will be much more discussion in the coming months about the engagement of the mission, but I want to show you, I want to tell you this morning how much our leadership is committed to this new emphasis on engaging our mission. Our leadership is wanting to emphasize how important winning and building and sending is, because we've decided to hire a new staff member to help us with this responsibility. You see, we've identified that one of the most under-discipled age demographic is our college and young adult age. So as soon as we have finalized the job description for this new position, we will diligently be seeking to hire a new associate minister who will be our point person in reaching and discipling our young adults. So please be in prayer for this process. Listen, I'm excited what God is going to do with this current young generation. I'm excited how he's going to use Jerome in reaching our young adults. My son John, who started interning here this summer, has helped us get the ball rolling. We've got a new Sunday night Y'all Life group for our young adults over across the parking lot in the mission house. And that's going to be going on every Sunday night. But he'll be going back to school in a couple months. And I don't know if we'll have somebody hired by then. It's doubtful. Maybe God will do it. But I want to keep things rolling. So we may need to ask some of you to help bridge that gap and keep things rolling. So besides pray, what can you do? Well, begin to prepare your heart for the changes we will have to make to be more excellent and how we engage the mission of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You see, I believe this summer series will help us do that. This red letter opportunities that we want to ask you to seek. These are opportunities that you will have, not just during our sermons, but throughout your summer, to engage the red letters, to engage the word of Jesus. When you do so honestly, with a thirst, when you engage the words of Jesus and surrender to his will, then you will find that engagement into his great commission will just come naturally. You will hunger and thirst to do it. And so this morning, I encourage you to sit back, prepare yourself for a red letter summer.
All right, if you've got your Bibles, flip open to Luke chapter 1. I need you to understand how much the Holy Spirit has changed me. This morning, as Jason was preaching, I'm standing right back there and have access to the computer. You don't know how much I wanted to hijack the screen and have the next click come up and say, you said this would be short. That's what I wanted it to say. He's out here giving the state of the church address. All right, anyway, so we have red letter summer. I'm not going to feel bad about preaching this whole sermon now, so don't even start yawning or looking at your watch and doing any of that. I'm not putting up with it. This is my time. All right, so Luke chapter 1 is where I want us to be as we kick off this new series. I know you know this passage. Okay, it's going to start in verse 26. I know you're aware of this, and I know you think this is the wrong time of year to read this. It is not. Okay, look at verse 26. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee. Okay, so think of it this way, like city and state. Indianapolis, Indiana, you have Nazareth in Galilee. Galilee is like the state. Okay, so go to Nazareth, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she, who was said to be barren, is in her sixth month, for nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said," and then the angel left her. Keep going in verse 39. At that time, Mary then got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judah, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth, look at these words, this is important, Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. So the moment Mary comes into her presence, the Holy Spirit fills Elizabeth. So these words she's about to exclaim to Mary are not her words. These are the words of the Holy Spirit of God. And the Holy Spirit says to Mary in a loud voice, Elizabeth exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." Okay, so let me start by saying this. We are an incredibly arrogant people. And I don't say that just about this congregation, although this congregation is incredibly arrogant. The people of our community are incredibly arrogant. The people in Indiana, the people of the United States, the people of North America, the people of the world are incredibly arrogant people. And there's a lot of different ways that you could assess that. But specifically, the reason I say that we are arrogant is because we read this passage or we hear this passage and we think, oh, that was very normal for them. Angels are popping up all over the place, and so nobody had a real problem with it. Hey, there's an angel, and they're proclaiming something, as though this was a normal occurrence for them, for an angel to show up and give them a word. Now, I understand when you read Scripture, which doesn't tell the story of every family that existed all those years ago, it seems like it happens pretty frequently, because those are the things that are recorded. But I need you to understand something. We say things like this, oh, those people back then were really superstitious, and they had no problem believing the supernatural. What are we thinking? Why do we come to that conclusion? Just look at that word for a second, supernatural. Anything that happens that is supernatural, what does the word mean? The word supernatural means it is beyond what is natural, okay? So a virgin having a baby, that isn't natural. It isn't natural today. We wouldn't believe it today. It wasn't natural then. Virgins weren't popping out kids back then. This wasn't a normal occurrence. Okay, the parting of the Red Sea, or today, somebody that has all kinds of cancer goes in, they get a scan, and it's a clean bill of health, and the doctors say, we have no idea how this happened. That's not natural. It wasn't natural now. It wouldn't have been natural then either. The word supernatural means beyond the natural limits of human understanding. Anytime God involves himself, it's going to be a supernatural event. We can't understand that. We wouldn't understand a virgin having a child today. They didn't understand it then either. Yes, it is true, they knew less about the natural world. We have discovered things and learned things, but don't get arrogant. The reason that we've discovered them and learned them is because we're standing on the shoulders of those giants who paved the way. We're not wiser, we're not smart. Man, you think we're wiser? Look at the philosophers of today, the ones that they put on The View, the ones that go on HBO. Those are our philosophers today. Compare those minds to Socrates and Aristotle and Plato. Where do we get the idea that we're so much smarter today? Having no explanation for things that didn't make any more sense to them than it does to us. This is my point. You and I have such a paternalistic, insulting view of our ancestors. We think of them as these knuckle-dragging morons that beat women over the head with a club and drug them back to their cave, and that's how we view our ancestors. So, yeah, I mean, Mary has an angel show up. She's totally going to believe that to be the case. Look at this passage and notice how much Mary is struggling, just like you and I would, when something like this occurs. She can't understand this. She can't believe what she's hearing because it makes no sense. It wouldn't make sense now, and it didn't make sense then. Also, Mary's been raised a Jewish girl. She's probably 14 or 15. Her whole life, she's been going to the synagogue. She's been doing the Jewish thing. And she knows the entire concept of God becoming human. That's impossible, and it's insulting. I don't know if you're aware of this, but Orthodox Jews, even today, will not write the name of God. They do not feel qualified to write the name of God. He is too holy. So they'll write it G with a hyphen and then D. I had a Jewish student in one of my classes, and whenever she would write an essay and she would mention the name of God, she would write it that way because God is too holy. Okay, that's the customs that she's coming from. The idea that God would lower himself to the level of humanity, that's insulting. It's heresy. One of the most perplexing things that you see in the New Testament to these people, people who follow Jesus, people who confess, Peter and Mary Magdalene, that Jesus was the Son of God, they could never grasp Jesus' predictions that he was going to die. They really struggled with it. You remember when Jesus says that and Peter answers back? Yes. Oh, no, Lord, that's never going to happen to you. And then Jesus calls him Satan. That's when you know you've screwed up. But he calls him Satan because you don't understand. I have to die. But they never understood that. And here's why. If he was Messiah, that means he is of God or from God, and God couldn't die. That doesn't make sense. That isn't natural. It isn't logical. So all of his talk about his resurrection and coming back on the third day, that was incredibly confusing to them. It was incredibly concerning to them. My point that I'm trying to make is this. Mary had rational barriers to her belief. You and I have rational barriers to our belief. Don't think that Mary didn't have the exact same thing. And by the way, her rational barriers came with something else. If she really believes this and it really happens, that's a huge personal crisis for her as well. So she doesn't want to believe that this is. It's not as though an angel shows up and says, hey, Mary, you're going to be pregnant. And she says, well, I was waiting for that. I knew you'd be coming at some point. Boop. That's not how that plays out. She wasn't anticipating anything like this. It's not just us that have rational barriers. There has never, ever been a time when God's intervention into the natural affairs of man has made sense or seemed normal. He is supernatural, so any action he takes will always be beyond our understanding. And here, Mary is really struggling to believe that God is speaking to me. I mean, you can imagine this scene. Okay, is this real? Are you really an angel? Are you really proclaiming this to me? She's struggling with that. And I'm going to suggest to you that over the course of the next couple months, you may struggle as well. Struggle with the idea that God is speaking to you through those red letters. You see, here's the difference. God spoke to Mary through an angel. I don't anticipate God's going to be speaking to you through an angel. Although some of you probably, when I'm speaking the words, I'm not going to say it. You can finish it for yourself. He's going to speak to us not through the voice of an angel, not through the appearance of an angel. He's going to speak to us through his red letters faithfully preserved down through the ages. And you and I may struggle with the idea that this is really God speaking to us. The challenge that I have for you this morning is respond as Mary did. That's why I call it in the little bulletin there, our Mary moment. You and I have the opportunity to respond as she did. How does she respond? The first important thing that I need you to grasp is look at Mary, and she responds with reason. Here's what skeptics will say in our culture. I'm not even going to call them skeptics. I'll call them scoffers. Scoffers will pretend that in order to believe in Jesus, you have to suspend your rational thoughts. You have to suspend reason to come to a belief in the supernatural. You just have to. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not wired that way. I couldn't do it. The reason that I am a convicted, convinced, 100% on board, I'm clinging to the cross for the rest of my life Christian, the reason that I believe that there is nothing in my life that is more important than proclaiming these words is because, using my reason and logic, I've concluded this is the only thing that makes sense. This is the only explanation for what I see around me that even begins to make sense. It is because of my reason that I have faith. I can't do the blind faith thing. I can't do it. I have to have a reason for why I believe. Let me give you an example of what blind faith is. This was a tweet, even though they don't call them that anymore because it's not Twitter anymore, it's X. So this was an X that came out not too long ago. And some of you may not know this. Those of you that are engaged in the field, you might. At the highest level, scientists have admitted that random mutation and natural selection are insufficient mechanisms to explain the existence, the complexity, and the variety of life. They are exploring alternative theories. They have been for decades. Darwinism has been dead for a while, but they've just kept it quiet. A lot of people don't realize that, but it's true. Darwinism has been dead for a long period of time. What is Darwinism? Some people believe that Darwinism is, we're going to look at all of the evidence here and then come to a conclusion, was there a creator or wasn't there a creator? That wasn't Darwinism. Darwin was going to study to be a minister. He knew this story over here. What Darwin said was, is there a way, if we began with the belief that there was no God, is there a way to explain all of this out there? Do you see? You're begging the question. You've already determined there is no God, and here's my best explanation for how it would happen. And so that's the whole idea of Darwinism. How could we explain all the variety of life without the existence of a God? And so what do they come up with? Well, we got to find a way that things could evolve into each other. And then so he came up with random mutation and natural selection. You remember what I said earlier, that we've learned a lot of things through the years? Well, one of the things that we've learned is that mutations and natural selection, that's not a good explanation for how new stuff can come about. And the scientists, leading scientific minds, they know that. They've admitted it. It's why they're looking for an alternative. But they're still teaching it. Why are they still teaching it? Because they don't have an alternative theory. And they know they can't accept the opposite, that there's a creator. So until we have an alternative theory, what are we going to do? We're going to suspend reason. We know this doesn't explain it. We know this doesn't answer the questions, but we don't have anything better. That's what I can't do. I can't put my blind faith in something that I know isn't true. That's the suspension of reason. And that is not what Mary does in this account. Look at verse 29. You got it open. Look at verse 29. Mary was greatly troubled at the words of the angels and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. Okay, we look at that word wondered, and here's how we view the word wondered. Ah, I wonder what this is going to be. This is kind of exciting. That's not what wondered means. If you look at the original language, the word there, see if you can pick up on a word within this word that might make sense to you. Deologistico. Any word come to mind when you see that? Yeah, good. Yeah, it was mumbling. I don't know if you really said it or not. It means to use logic. That's what the scripture says she's doing. She's sitting there and reasoning with intensity. Can I make sense out of this? Everything that I've learned and everything that I've seen and everything that is occurring to me now, she's reasoning, does it make sense that this could be God speaking to me? She's trying desperately to figure it all out. I think she's a great example for us. Will we do the same thing when these words that are written in red hit us? And they challenge us, will we reason with intensity? She ponders the evidence. She weighs the internal consistency of the claims. And she concludes, this has to be true. She comes to the conclusion, this has to be true. My question is, are we going to reason to weigh what we're going to hear? Are we going to take what we hear and reason with it and come to a conclusion? That's the question. But also, here's the second thing Mary does. And this might surprise you that I'm encouraging you to do this summer. Mary openly expresses her doubts. Openly expresses her doubts. You remember what we said earlier, or I said earlier? She doesn't respond to the angel and say, well, hey, you're an angel, so okay, here we go. That isn't her response to all of this. No, she says what every rational person would say. Look at verse 34. Again, we have this stupid view of our ancestor. She responds the way you and I would. How will this be? Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin. Okay, virgins weren't having kids back then any more than they are today. So she looks at the angel and said, okay, I'm not sure if you're familiar with how things work, but in order for there to be a child, there must be a mama and there must be a papa. And so far there has been no papa, therefore there must be no baby. Okay, she explains this to the angel. This doesn't make any sense how this is going to be. She is honest about her uncertainty and she's honest about her doubts. I think there's a difference that you and I need to note here. I really want you to notice this. I've heard it explained this way. The difference between honest doubts and dishonest doubts. What is a dishonest doubt? A dishonest doubt would be for Mary to respond and say, that's crazy. You're crazy. I can't believe this. I gotta be going crazy. None of this makes sense. It's stupid. There's no way. And you turn and you walk the other way. That's a dishonest doubt. In fact, it's not even a doubt. You're dismissing something. You're rejecting it out of hand. Not even thinking about it. It's an assertion. It's an accusation. That's crazy. You're crazy. Case closed. No way this is true. It's not a doubt. It's not an argument. In fact, it's a way to avoid thinking. That's what a lot of people do with Christianity. Oh, no, that's stupid. The idea that there's a God of the universe. No, it's dumb. And they turn and they walk away. They refuse to engage the evidence. Honest doubts, that's what causes you questions that you then think about. And that's what I'm saying Mary did, and I'm hoping that we will do. Because questions that cause you to think, they're humble. By their very nature, they are humble. You're asking questions. You're not building walls of unbelief. Honest doubts implicitly acknowledge something. You don't have all the answers. I don't have all the answers. In other words, honest doubts are open to belief. If I see enough evidence, then I will believe this to be the case. And God will use that humility. How do I know that He'll use that humility? When you honestly are seeking truth, hold your finger in Luke 1 because we're coming right back to it. But flip over to Matthew 7 or don't. Just rustle your pages and people will think it, and I'm going to read it. Verse 7, this is the words of Jesus, red letters. You might have noticed that opening passage of the red letter summer had no red letters in it. But here are some red letters, all right? I didn't want anybody mouthing at me. Verse 7, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, the door will be opened. Now we can interpret that passage in bad ways. When I was a younger lad, there was a female I was interested in. And I wanted to be interested in me. And so I tried to use this as leverage with God. And said, you clearly say that if I ask, it will be given to me. I am now asking and am eagerly anticipating you giving me this gift. I'm knocking on the door and let's see it open here. Okay, God isn't persuaded by my misinterpretation of Scripture. So that never took off. So what is the proper interpretation of this? When you are earnestly seeking truth, when you are honestly seeking Him, you'll find Him. I see, He promises that to be the case. And not only will you be blessed by the expression of your honest doubts, not only will He fulfill and be honest and faithful, do you know it's not just going to be you that is blessed by your honestly expressed doubts? Look at verse 37, back in Luke chapter 1, verse 37. Do you remember this verse? For nothing is impossible with God. Okay, can I tell you how many times I have used that verse and relied on that verse? You know how powerful that verse, how many of us has been helped by those words? Something difficult that we're going through, we don't see how God is going to see us through, and those words of the angel, nothing is impossible with God. Okay, you know the reason we have those words? Pause to consider, had Mary not honestly expressed her doubts, we would have never had that incredible revelation in Scripture that I've come to rely on. It's not just you that are blessed when you express openly your honest doubts. It's others as well. Who knows but what the person next to you doesn't have the same doubt but lacks the courage to express it. And both of you can be built up in the faith if you express those doubts and those concerns. I get our fear that our doubts will somehow dishonor God, but if they're sincere, they don't dishonor God. Not at all. Now, are there doubts that dishonor God? Sure. If they're mocking, God's not going to be mocked. But if they are sincere doubts and you are earnestly seeking truth, it doesn't dishonor Him. Jason mentioned our mission here to win, build, and send, which is nothing but a restatement of the Great Commission. Okay? We dumbed it down Greentown style. That's what we did with the Great Commission. That's what the mission is. So let me ask you a question. How effective are you going to be if you are quietly harboring nagging doubts? How effective are you going to be at winning and building and sending others if you are quietly harboring nagging doubts that you need answers to but you won't express? How much more will we grow by expressing them and seeking truth? Can I tell you? There have been multiple times in my life where Dick Mosier or Bob Eikenberry or Bob Ellis or John Dean or Ben Reed or Phil Evenson or John Dean, even Bill Heck on occasion, that those guys, when I've had honest doubts and I've had questions about things and I've expressed them, that I think are these monumentally difficult questions and I don't know, this is challenging my faith, and hear one of them say, oh, yeah, I used to struggle with that too, but, and then they open up the scriptures. Do you know how much that's built my faith and my confidence? Some of you are sitting out there harboring those doubts. Don't sit on them. Let your faith be built by brothers and sisters in Christ. What in the world are we scared of? It shouldn't be. God isn't scared of our questions. Only when we confront our doubts, only when we confront our doubts like Mary did, can we get to the point that Mary got to, which is point number three. You notice how she surrendered completely. That's what I'm hoping that we'll get to this summer. And the question is, how did she get there so fast? I love this. This hit me this week, and it kind of gave me chills. Do you know how she got there so fast? Combine the first 2 points of what she did, and you'll see how she got there so fast. The first thing she did, she openly expressed her doubts over how this is possible. This doesn't make sense. Virgins don't have babies. Nothing's clicking here, angel. She openly expresses her doubts. She gets the answer. The answer is, Mary, you're thinking naturally. This is a supernatural event. With God, anything is possible. You got to think that way, Mary. And then she uses her reason to evaluate that argument of the angel. And if you've never picked up on this, that's actually a really good argument. You're talking about God here, Mary. Stop and think about this for just a second. Do you believe in an omnipotent God that created the heavens and the earth? That spoke everything into existence. Those of you that don't believe or don't know if you believe that, I'm gonna set you to the side. I'm gonna put you on the old John Deere for a second. The rest of us that do in fact believe that there is an omnipotent creator that has spoken the universe into existence. Mary believed that. Mary was raised her whole life as a faithful Jew. So the angel is saying, you believe in a God that pre-existed all things, that was uncreated and spoke the universe into existence. Is that correct? And Mary says, yeah, that's correct. And you think that that same God would be incapable of putting a child into your womb? Is that what I'm understanding? And then what does Mary say? I guess that's true. That doesn't really make any sense. Bingo! That's what I'm trying to get across to you. If you really believe that there is, and this is where I am, I've come to believe based on evidence that there is an omnipotent, almighty creator of heavens and the earth who spoke everything into existence, then what is it that seems too crazy to actually wrap your mind around? Does it seem too crazy that a man lived for 3 days in the belly of a fish? Do you know there was a time in my life where I thought I needed to explain how that could happen naturally? And I'm looking for, well, if there was an air pocket in the belly of the fish and the man had enough and he could have some sort of snorkel that extended out of the blowhole, I'm thinking of all of these different things. I don't need to do that. If I'm talking about a God that can, with a flicker of his eyelash, set off earthquakes and tsunamis, is it really that radical to think he could keep a dude alive in the belly of a fish if he wanted to? Anything is possible once you understand the nature of God. A donkey speaking to Balaam. Okay, I've never seen a donkey talk before. I'd be a little freaked out if it happened. It's not a natural occurring event. But is it beyond the realm of possibility that the God of the universe, that just with his spoken word created everything, that he says, I want to get a hold of this guy, I want to get his attention, I think I'm going to use the donkey to do it. Hey, everybody watch this. And freaks the guy out with the donkey. Could God do it? Of course he could do that. There's nothing. The sun's standing still. Do you know what would happen if the sun stopped or the earth stopped spinning and it made it look like the sun is standing still? Gravity would stop and we'd all float off into the right. Okay, I understand. Naturally, that is impossible. We're talking about a super. If you're talking about the God who hung the sun in the heavens, I think he's entirely capable of doing that if he wants to do it. A man being born to a virgin? Yeah, totally within the realm of possibility if you accept the existence of a supernatural. None of that stuff comes close to hampering my belief in miraculous supernatural events once I've accepted that there is a supernatural. And Mary decided this was God speaking to her, so no matter how unnatural, no matter how out of the mainstream it was going to make her, she would believe, she would trust, and she would obey. Church, I know some of you are fading because Jason took entirely too long, but I need you to look at that right there. I'm just kidding. Anyway, look at this right here one more time. Please look at this. She decided, God is really speaking to me. This is the God of the universe that is speaking to me and telling me something. So no matter how unnatural it makes me to believe it, no matter how out of the mainstream, no matter what people say about me, what they post about me on Jerusalem Facebook, no matter what it is that they do or say and how unnatural or out of the mainstream it makes me look, I'm going to believe it. I'm going to trust it, and I'm going to obey. Man, I hope that's us. That's what I want from this summer. This summer, that's why I called it our Mary moment. I hope that you and I will become convinced these red letters, this is the Son of God that is speaking to me. So no matter how unnatural it makes me in a culture that is increasingly hostile to Christianity and the words of Jesus, constantly trying to twist Jesus' words to mean something that they don't, no matter how out of the mainstream my confidence in these words make me, I will believe, I will trust, and I will obey, regardless of what man may say or do. The question is, will we surrender as she did? Why is that there? I don't know why that's there, and it's really bothering me. I think Jason's messing in the back because he heard me talking about it. I want you to look at verse 38. Look at verse 38 right here. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. You know another word for servant that would be translated here? Slave. I am the Lord's slave. And I know that we don't like that word. It has negative connotations, obviously, with American history. But we're to be slaves to Christ. And that's what Mary says. I'm a slave. I am a slave to God. May it be to me as you have said. And then the angel left her. Things that you and I may read in the coming weeks may challenge us. They'll challenge our preferences, the things that we prefer. They will challenge our attitudes, the way we want to think about other people. They will challenge our politics. Now, I've always believed this, and I think this is what we should believe. And suddenly those red letters are going to fly in the face of that. That's why in Luke chapter 14, Jesus says, you remember this? You need to count the cost before you decide to be my disciple. Know what it's going to cost you before you engage this. Before you follow me, you figure out what it's going to cost you. You know what it's going to cost you? Everything. Is it worth it? That's what Jesus says in that passage. Many of us as believers fall into the trap of negotiating the cost. That's what we do. We don't count the cost. We negotiate the cost. We want to give up some things, but we don't want to give up all things. We want conditional surrender to the Savior. We don't want unconditional surrender. We want to decide what it is that we'll give up. Hey, if you do that, if you decide what you will give up for the cause of Christ, who is sitting on the throne of your life? It isn't Christ. You're dictating the terms to Him. I will follow you if this. I'll follow you as long as this. As long as I can still believe this, as long as I can still do this, then I will follow you. You're on the throne. You can call that whatever you want, but don't call it Christianity, because that's not what Christianity is. Jesus sits on the throne. Slaves didn't get to pick their tasks. Slaves didn't get to say no. I'm not interested in the fields today. It's a little toasty. I'm not going to head out there. No, I don't really want to head to the threshing room floor. Whatever it was that the slave wanted to do didn't matter. And you and I are slaves to Christ. That's what we're told. Saying, I will obey if, is not, it's not unconditional, and it's not obedience. And that's what you and I are called to do. Finally, number four, she finds godly fellowship. She goes straight to Elizabeth. That's where she goes. That's why I read through that portion. As soon as she surrendered, she went straight to a fellow believer, to Elizabeth, and speaks to her, and Elizabeth speaks with the Spirit's power. You saw that. Here's what I don't want you to miss. I don't want you to miss what happens to Mary because of this. Remember who we're talking about. 15-year-old girl who can't make sense out of any of this, finally accepts it, finally surrenders. She goes to Elizabeth. Elizabeth speaks with the power of the Holy Spirit. And suddenly, what happens to Mary? As soon as Elizabeth is done speaking the Spirit's truth, I did not read this passage to you. I ended in verse 45, but look, I'm not going to read it, but look starting in verse 46 at that section that follows. You know what follows? Mary breaks into a song. She starts singing, but this isn't just any song. No, the banger that she turns out right here is totally written by God. These aren't Mary's words. There's no way Mary could come up with this. This is the Holy Spirit of God now flowing through Mary. This song is often called the Magnificat. These magnificent words that only could come from the Father. You know, if you read this, what you're going to see, you're going to see the Old Testament is what you're going to see. You're going to see the book of Psalms. You're going to see Isaiah. You're going to see the prophets, all in this song of Mary. What's going on here? This song is making remarkable connections to the Old Testament that Mary had grown up reading and knowing. She knew these scriptures, and they're now justifying and validating and revealing the coming Messiah. This is incredible if you think about it. This confused, scared young woman is now offering incredible biblical insights. That's the power of the Holy Spirit. Okay, look, man, here's what I'm going to say to you. Some of us are having some real spiritual struggles right now. And some of you haven't told anybody that, but you're sitting there quietly struggling. Some of us are hiding from it. We're hiding our doubts. We're hiding the spiritual struggles that we're in. Maybe this last series where we looked at sin, it really convicted us about stuff. But like I said last week, we're not really sure we want to change. Some of us are having spiritual battles. And some of us don't know that we're having spiritual battles, but we soon will, because those red letters, I don't know what just happened to me, the red letters that we're about to read are going to reveal some real spiritual struggles that we have. And I am telling you, Christians, there is power here. There is power that is just being waited to be tapped into. Tim Keller writes it this way, the theologian, look at what he says. Mary was a nobody who became greater than everybody, simply because God came to her and she responded in the humblest possible way. That's how it happened for Mary. And that's how I'm praying it happens for us. This will be our Mary moment. And it is my prayer, and I hope you will be praying the same thing, that not just in the passages that we'll read and not just in the sermons that I'm praying the Holy Spirit will preach to all of us, but the reflection questions that'll be in there for you to think about through the week, I am hoping that God will come to you over the course of the next several weeks. You know what I honestly hope, and maybe this is silly, but I actually hope that you get anxious about Sunday. I really do. I mean, I do, and I really hope, not because of me, but I hope that you're kind of like, oh man, it's only Thursday. I'm really anxious for Sunday to get here because you want to be tapped into this power. You want the change that comes from these words, and I believe that it can happen. We have the same chance as Mary, a chance to reason the words of God, a chance to freely express our doubts, a chance to fully surrender to Him, and notice the highlighted words, just like Mary and Elizabeth, that we can do all of that together and build the body of Christ. Father God, I thank you for your truth. I thank you. I thank you for those red letters. I thank you that you saw us struggling humanity and knew that not only did we need a Savior, but we needed a guide. We needed a foundation. We needed a lamp for our feet, and you provided that in your word. And Father, over the course of the next several weeks, I pray that those red letters would come to life for us in a way that they never have before. I pray that hearts would be changed and minds would be altered and transformed, that we would give up sitting on the throne of our own lives. And I know why we do it. Out of anxiety, we want to be accepted by others. We want to keep our jobs. We want to be popular, all of those things. We want to be cool and hip and have people think great things about us. Father, let us set that to the side. Let us not chase after the applause of men, but instead chase after your heart. Seek the applause of heaven. Father, I'm asking that you will change me over the course of these several weeks. I've seen it happen before, and I'm praying it'll happen again. But I don't want it to just be me. Father, I want it to be this body that you've brought together faithfully. Nobody's here by accident. And I pray that this divine appointment is you preparing to meet them and speak the words of life to them that will change us and alter us from being a people just meandering our way through life, waiting for the end of it, to people who are purposed and people who are urgent to spread the gospel, to win others, to build them up in the faith, and to send them out to make more disciples. Father, that is our prayer, and we ask it in the name of, above every other name, the name of Jesus Christ, and everyone said, amen. If you have a decision to make, you want to follow Jesus, this is your chance. Would you come as we stand and as we sing?